Hello, and welcome for Time for Hemp. Today on our show, we're going to be discussing the legalization of hemp, the most wonderful plant in the universe. Today on our show, we have Jack Herer and Captain Ed discussing this. They're two of the main proponents on the initiative that they're putting on the ballot in 1992 to legalize cannabis hemp as a productive crop for fuel, fiber, paint, and industrial use.
Industrial uses, medicinal uses, nutritional uses, and personal use in private is the way we call it.
Okay, okay. And I take it you and Captain Ed have been working side by side on this for a long time. How did the two of you meet? And tell me a little bit about yourself, Captain Ed.
Well, I owned a shop in the early 70s called Heads and Highs. Okay. And at that time, the California Marijuana Initiative started up. And we ended up getting it on the ballot and getting, how many, a million signatures at that time?
Half a million.
Half a million signatures, and I met Jack at that time, and we've been working in the hemp movement ever since.
Wow. That's a simple version. I came into the store to pick up the boxes because I had a car, and nobody else in the movement had a car. I came to pick up the donation boxes they sent me out. I said, I'm not going to give it to you. You look too straight to me. We became friends. Early 1973.
He had on his fossil fuel suit.
Right.
Polyester.
Anyway, I got to know Ed. I went to the first meeting, my first statewide meeting with him, with my son Mark and Captain Ed in a little Pinto. We went up to San Luis Obispo, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And we found out it's a really strange thing that we had all the same similar experiences as a kid. And after he had told me all about marijuana and the marijuana legalization, this guy made me promised to work to legalize marijuana until I was dead.
Ah, you did that?
Yeah, until I was dead, it was legal, or I turned 84, and we had a shake on it, and we agreed to this, and smoke a joint on it, and that we agreed to do this because we knew that a lot of people didn't know the information we know. Of course, we thought Normal would tell them, or other people would tell them. We didn't realize it would be him and I all along. But we made this agreement, and we thought it'd be legal by 75, 76, because of all the incredibly positive medical stories that are coming out about marijuana extending your life, being good for you, good for your glaucoma, chemotherapy, lowering stress. We were sure pot would be legal, totally, by 76, 77. So I didn't mind making an agreement when I was 33 years old to not quit till I was 84, because I figured it'd only take two or three more years to legalize it.
Okay.
Wow.
I'm very surprised.
It just shows you.
Now, I've had a chance to listen to you talk a little bit about one of the problems why it's not legalized. And Captain Ed, you seem to focus at the fact that people don't get out there and vote, and that there seems to be a real drawback to people getting to the polls, and that they need to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. My other organization is Vote, Victory Over the Enemy.
Hey, I like that.
Which is the unregistered voter in the state of California.
Oh, okay.
What we have to do is upgrade our standard of voting. We can send people to the moon, and we're sending satellites into outer space. I believe that our system of voting in this country is very antiquated, very old. It needs to be renewed and revised and updated. I think that the voting should be more important than Christmas.
Okay.
I think that we should spend a lot of money on educating the people. Look at it this way. The government is in favor of the United States public to vote. I feel that it's our duty to show them, or to find a way to help the government find ways to help people vote. And I think with television, the telephone, computer optics, and satellite dishes, and all this technology that we've got, we should be able to sit home and vote on all these important issues. And I'm sure the government wants everybody to vote. It's our constitutional right, and they stand behind it. I think that they should get behind us and help us to get out there and make voting a very important issue. It is important, even if you're not in favor of, say, the California Marijuana Initiative or the Hemp Initiative, that's fine. We would love for you to come out and speak your opinion. We want you out there voting. We want you to take an active part in this country. If you do, then I think this will solve the problem.
Also, isn't it true that if you end up behind bars because of some of the laws pertaining to hemp, marijuana, that you lose your right to vote when you come out? And it's very important that someone who may have a brother or a sister or a loved one in jail who can't get out there and vote their peace of mind should go out there and cast that vote to help set them free.
Absolutely.
Your opinion doesn't count until you vote.
That's
yeah.
right.
And that's it. It's just an opinion. That's
no reason
fine.
To
just
complain like, unless you pull the chain.
Just like, well, I can't say that in the air.
Now, how did you all become involved in this political action?
Well,
Fred, you got, he brought me in. I'm still the new kid on the block to him. I've only been doing this 18 years. He's been doing it 20.
Wow.
I still work for him.
Okay.
I was in one of the biggest movements ever in this country after we ended the war in Vietnam. It was automatic. It seemed that we were going to end the marijuana prohibition in this country. And the wave of enthusiasm that went through this country in 1972, the young people that went out there and worked for this thing, at that time we had no leader like we have Jack now, who's leading this whole campaign and doing a magnificent job. I'm so proud of him. I can't believe it. But at that time, we had no heads in 1971, 72. It was just the people so caught up in this movement that they were running in from all over everywhere and coming to me, and they educated me on it, and they got me into it. I didn't know anything when I first started in this.
Who were the people that got you involved?
It was the people on the street that would run into me and say, did you hear there's a marijuana initiative on the ballot? And I went, no, I didn't know any of this. What's going on? He said, well, some guys in San Francisco, Gordon Brunell and Michael Alridge, who owned a Morphier paper company, had sponsored this California marijuana initiative, and it just kind of like grew, and everybody was going around. There were no bosses. When I started in this, and I got over 140,000 signatures out of my store in a five-month period, and I didn't even know I did it, because I didn't know what I was doing. I was young and dumb, you know, and full of excitement. You know, I really thought this was the greatest thing in the world, and we were going to change the world. At that time, I knew nothing about the benefits of marijuana except the, you know, getting high, and I didn't think it was a bad thing. And
Have either of you gotten disillusioned down your road of path? I mean, you've got to come across a lot of people who are like walls, and so many days in and days out, and floods of sweat, and people, you're going 17 hours a day, and the people you hire only want to go home in 8 hours, and you're pulling your hair out saying, this can't be, you got to...
We've registered over hundreds of thousands of people in the last 20 years, and Jack and I have been on the streets. The two most important reasons people don't vote in this country, they're afraid. They're afraid they'll lose their job. They're afraid the government will find out and take their firstborn. I stand there and talk to these people. I cannot believe that in this country, I'm hearing this. Now, if I was in Russia or somewhere like that, 20 years ago I was hearing this, and today it's even worse.
Police Chief Ed Davis of Los Angeles in 72 took the California Marijuana Initiative, went in there with his people, with his intelligence people to the register of voters and pulled the names of the people that signed it and said he was going after it. There was such a hue and cry that that it was illegal for anybody in government ever to see a petition again, and special laws were written.
Whoa.
But then Chief Daryl Gates in 1982 or early 83 went into Lion's Lair, a store, and seized the petitions, had his police officers say that they were going to seize our petitions in there, and arrested the people in the store and said that they were going to use the names on that had signed the marijuana petition to go after and see what other type of illegal activities they were doing. Well, that has a hell of a chilling effect on people.
Can he do that?
Ed and I stood our ground, went against him, went through the newspapers. The newspapers finally brought him up over and over again until he apologized and gave the petitions back, and they agreed not to look at them. But do you see what kind of chilling effect that has? Hey, you want to sign a petition? Oh, no.
It's almost like they don't want us to register people to vote.
Yeah, well,
and
Daryl
that's
Gates has got a reputation
the most American thing
you
can do.
I went to jail for 15 days for registering voters after dark on federal property in 1981, I think it was, registering voters at the FBI building. Ed and I had set up a 24-hour-a-day voter registration booth and signed the marijuana initiative in 1982. And we took over the outside of the building, not the inside, but
the outside.
Busiest intersection in the United States at the corner of Wilshire and Veteran, between Veteran and Sepulveda. And here we had 92,000 cars a day, thousands of people parking behind the FBI building, and they arrested us, and they said, you cannot do this. I said, well, I'm not going to pay you a fine or go on probation. So I did 15 days in prison rather than give them a $5 fine.
Wow.
That's kind of like telling Jesus you can't practice on Sunday.
It was a fine line, the sidewalk.
Okay, now we've got a clip of the two of you here running through some hemp fields, I believe. I don't know if you should say the state or not. Do you think it's safe to say what state?
Omaha, Nebraska.
Omaha, Nebraska. Working very hard and exploring the wonderful things that make you inspired, shall we say. Right. Can we see that tape, please?
This patch right here?
Yeah, keep going, by the bridge.
Look at it. Let's pull it all and take it home. What are we talking about?
Now, keep going up by these trees.
Look at this. Marijuana, folks, growing wild. Look at this.
Look at this.
Hang on.
Right up here. There's a whole patch.
This? That's marijuana?
All that right back there is. Right
is this
here.
Marijuana?
Yeah, pull up here.
Can I pull over now?
Pull over. You're here, brother. This is it. Look at the patch.
Ah, don't go too far.
Relax.
It might be soft, yeah.
Marijuana, growing wild. Look at this, folks. Look at this. This is hemp. This is hemp. None of this is female, though. This is all male. Look at this. Look at the seeds.
Here, get a picture of us in the marijuana field.
Yeah, on, Jack. Where's Jack?
Come in here.
Jack, get inside.
Come on in here. Film.
Yeah, why don't you guys get buried inside of it, and I'll find you inside of it, okay? Try not to destroy it all. Okay. Wow, look at this. It's a marijuana patch. Growing wild. Oh, who do we have in the marijuana patch but Jack Herer and Ed Adair?
Well, hi, guys.
They're on, they must be
We're
on the hemp tour. Are you on the hemp tour, guys?
We're on the hemp tour. Yeah.
We've got hemp.
Look at this.
Don't pull out that male plant.
This stuff's growing out.
Some females.
This is oxygen.
There's one right there.
What? This big one?
This one here, isn't it? It's a female.
That's a male.
These are taller than me.
All the big ones are males. All right, well.
Let's go back down the road and find some females and smoke them.
Hey, you want to pull the
males are.
Yeah, they butt too much before the females.
It smells so good.
You would be out of eyeshot of any of the operations.
You do whatever you want.
Look at this girl down
there.
Wow.
But this is where the grows back here.
Does it actually get
buds
in another couple months?
Yeah, but it's starting to bud now, some of them.
I just see the males. These are the males.
Some of them
are
the
white seeds. Oh, yeah, well, these are seeds.
These are the males here.
No, these aren't seeds. These are the males.
Here comes the car.
That's okay. We're just videotaping it. We're not picking it.
Well, if you don't pick it, I know
it. It's sitting here. It's organic matter.
I can't look at it even?
Yeah, really. Look at it.
Of the hemp. This is hemp land. We're going into hemp. Going into the hemp. Yes! We're inside of the hemp now. This is hemp. We're inside hemp. About 10 or 12 feet. See, look. See? This is the sky. Look at this great backcountry. This is natural wild hemp at its finest.
Look at the size of that.
I know.
That sucker's supposed to be about 9 feet.
About 10.
That makes my eyes red just looking at that. Who did the camera work on that?
My son Mark did, Mark
Herer. Yeah?
Yeah.
I bet he had a great day doing
yeah,
that.
Yeah, we had a great day. We couldn't smoke that leaf, though.
Nah. Yeah. Now, you said you found that where, in Nebraska?
Yeah, right outside the police academy, outside of Lincoln. It grows all along that area.
Yeah.
They grew 350,000 acres in the Midwest for the war.
Yeah, okay.
And there's still thousands of acres growing wild. In fact,
right.
If we sent our natural guard to Nebraska to plant hemp and turning it into methane, methanol, and catalyzing it back into gasoline,
okay.
Instead of sending our national guard to the Middle East to fight for oil, we would be saving this planet. You know, you won't save the planet no matter how much oil you burn and how many trees you cut down. But hemp is the best thing we have on Earth to replace the synthetic cycle and the fossil cycle with a natural cycle and to make all the paper on Earth.
Yeah, but now you're coming to the National Guard going to the Middle East. I mean, they're awfully busy, too, invading Humboldt County, aren't they?
Yeah.
They really have their hands full with this war.
Well, you know, I was in Hawaii a few weeks ago. While the war was still on, the National Guard was not allowed to go. None of the Hawaiian National Guard was allowed to go the Middle East because they had to stay home to protect. Actually fight the marijuana crops. They were there to fight a bigger enemy, Bush told them, than Saddam Hussein marijuana. I wonder if Bush knows he was holding on to pot when he jumped out of the parachute webbing was all made out of hemp.
Who knows what Bush knows? You know
what
I mean?
He probably passed laws so we can't find it out.
Now, why is it so important to the two of you that hemp succeed with this legalization? I mean, what is the real drive behind what?
Well, my drive behind it is the fact when we first started out, we were just wanting to get high and smoke pot. We'd run around to people and say, would you sign the marijuana initiative so we can get high?
Okay.
Okay.
And then I realized back in the early 1980s that this wasn't going to work, so I started looking for alternative reasons. I think it was the Medfly that came along back when we had our office over there on Victory Boulevard. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking of a way to save the farmers in this country, and all of a sudden I thought, well, you know, the hemp crop would be a good cash crop for the farmers to grow with this Medfly problem. And now with the problem with the government and the farmers losing all their farms and things like this, it's become such an environmental issue. Like we're saying right now, it's not marijuana anymore.
It's hemp.
It's the environment. We're fighting for this environment, and over the last 20 years, we've realized that we are trying to save the environment. We were trying to get high in the early days, but we've grown up.
We're still trying to get high.
We want to get high. There's nothing wrong with that. Well, but we have babies. We have little children. We want to save this planet. Yeah. We want to educate the public of the truth.
You know, we bet a $10,000 bet that nobody can prove our information wrong. Yeah. And where's the DEA agent? Where's the DEA agent? Where's the police officer? Where's the Daryl Gates? Where's the scientist from the Department of Agriculture that's got a better plant on Earth?
And let me take this moment. If anybody out there thinks that they want to come onto the show and debate Jack Herer, Captain Ed, or any of our other guests that we've had on the show, we'd love to have you on. And we'll give you equal right, equal time, and equal courtesy.
All you have to do is have facts. Facts.
Right. Facts.
No baloney, okay. No opinions. Just
look,
facts.
You know, I'd like to state one thing. The United States people are probably some of the most patriotic people in the world. You can see by this war that's going on. And it's a criminal act if these people have been lied to. Because they're too good, and they trust their leaders and their government, and they love their government and their people, and they trust anything these people say. Mm-hmm. And if they're lying to these people, then they're hurting the most beautiful people on the planet, as far as I'm concerned, because I love this country. I wouldn't want to live anywhere
it's
else.
It's kind of like the Kennedy
I'm fighting for my right.
Watergate, right?
I'm fighting for the right that we fought for and won. Yeah. We and hemp. And when we found out all the information on the hemp in the late 70s, and Ed said, come on, Jack, sit down and write a book of all this information that you know. Uh-huh. And we put it out. The first thing we did was get arrested by the police.
Yeah.
They even seized my typewriter from which I was putting out the hemp information. I had to sue Daryl Gates in public on television in 1983 to get back my typewriter.
That's censorship of the press.
I hate to think that our government would capitalize on the weakness of people, which alcohol and tobacco.
Okay, we've got about 1 minute left. I'd like to have the two of you to please speak to before we go into another roll-in. And I was wondering if you might take a moment to both of you speak, you know, what you really need to come through to you on this initiative, to the people who are involved.
You have to get good signatures. You got to be a registered voter, and you only sign registered voters. And if you do that, we're the all-volunteer initiative. And no volunteer initiative has made the California ballot since 1980, and that was a nuclear freeze. We're an all-volunteer initiative, and we can make it because you guys are going to come out and petition for us and with us every day and put it on the ballot. You already are. Now we have to teach you good signatures.
Okay. Now for our roll-in, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is Captain Ed coming to you from San Francisco, California. We're here on the set of the Doors movie. We're getting ready to be in the movie. As you can see, the bus is over here. Psalm is dancing around, having a great time, and I'm bending down here because the lens here. But this is an experimental tape, so we don't really have to be too serious about what we're doing. It's a lot of fun. We're having a great time. The Grateful Dead show was fantastic. The crowd was great. The food was not too good. But we got hired to come to San Francisco while we were here to be in this Doors movie. And get paid for it. We can pay to be hippies and hate Ashbury. I think that's kind of poetic in itself. And so here we are in San Francisco. I'm going to be taking a few pictures. Right over here is where the extras all are over here. And Haight Ashbury is like one street over, and that's where their drums are beating. And they're going to be doing some scenes. We're probably going to be driving the bus through here. They want to use it in the movie. So this is Captain Ed signing off for now, and I'll be talking at you later, along with some more interesting people along the way, on this 1990 tour of the Grateful Dead, The Doors, Rainbow Gatherings, and anything else that happens to come along. See you in a little while.
Boy, you really get around, don't you? You meet a lot of people.
I'll tell you, working in the hemp movement has taken me all over the world so far, and I'm loving
Even to
it.
Europe, right?
Even to Europe. With
even all over Europe with Jack's book and this message.
I walked around all over Europe with a great big box full of 50 books of The Emperor Wears No Clothes, bumper stickers and buttons, and I stood up in Frankfurt, Germany, all over Germany, Paris, England, selling this book and educating the Europeans.
And now we're in the Hemp Museum over there, right?
Yeah.
We're in the Hemp Museum over there.
Yep.
Okay, now I understand you're doing not just one, but two initiatives that you're working on. You're doing the hemp initiative to legalize hemp cannabis as a product, a crop and so on. And then there's this one for the fully informed jury. I guess the jury has to be told that they can change laws or something?
Well,
or
what's this all about? Jurors knew this information until 1967. When you served on a jury, you knew that if there was a bad law or you thought it was a bad law or you could listen to the defendant's motives, you could vote down a bad law. It was our protection. Before we had a Bill of Rights, we had this law.
I never knew that.
I know, we're not supposed to know. Since 1967, over a 1964 case, the government has outlawed that you find out or know that you have this right or you can't serve on a jury. When you serve on a jury, the judge asks in voir dire that he says to you that if any of you disagree with the law or as law is written, you must excuse yourself from the jury because you must follow the law as written. If any of you think that you can go your own way, then you cannot serve on the jury. Well, until 1967, that was a lie. Every juror knew that he had the right to overrule the judge.
What do you mean?
Well, the first rule in the law, from the Peter Zenger case in 1735, where the jury overruled the Crown, and the Crown said you couldn't say anything bad against him, and the jury came back innocent because he had told the truth about the Crown, until John Jay and Tom Jefferson said you've got to have juries as the final check and balances on the executive, legislative, and judicial branch.
Okay.
So what we've done is we're not changing any laws. We are proposing a constitutional amendment for California, and we hope for a model for the whole United States. And all it does is redelineate and tell what rights you have as a juror that's already the law, but if you know you have this right now in California, you can't serve on a jury. We're making it so you can have this right and know you have this right and serve.
If you know you're right.
If you know you have this right, you can't
serve
on a jury. It is your right. So you
now it's Republican to me.
It sounds like catch-22 to me.
In Kentucky, aren't they using this law
now? Well, half of all the prohibition cases in the 1920s and 30s ended in hung juries because the juries knew this, and the prosecutor and the government stopped prosecuting.
That's happening in Kentucky right now.
On a growing case. The purpose of this act is to assure that jurors are made aware of, A, the jurors' inherent right to judge whether the law or laws applicable to the case being tried are unjust or misapplied. B, the juror's traditional right to vote according to conscience. To this end, juries affected by this act shall be allowed to hear evidence concerning the defendant's motives. Whenever state or local government is one of the parties in any trial by jury, the court must inform the jurors that in addition to their responsibility to judge the facts of the case, they have the inherent right to judge the law itself. Well, now that you heard it, you already know you have this right, and it doesn't matter whether you vote for it. It's your law. This is your right. And the government took it away from you, and if you know you have this right, you can't serve on a jury.
That's insane.
You guys can't serve on a jury now unless you lie to the judge.
Some of you might
think you want to get excused from juries, but that's how we're making bad laws. The reason was so that bad government employees over bad public policy, judges, legislators, cops could not pass a bad law for things that displeased them and then grab up 12 of us and make them rubber stamp this bad law on our neighbor. We had a way out. We could say, hey, jury nullification. One of us could hang a jury or all of us could come back innocent and that person would go free because it was a bad law. Who would say to a person who's giving his child, for instance, marijuana for his asthma, where the kid's going to live a lot longer than if he uses the legal government medicine, when he can tell the jury that, what jury's going to come back and convict this person? Nobody's going to convict this person. Well, so the law doesn't want you to find out this information, so you can't hear defendant's motives. Under this, you will hear defendant's motives, and you can go according to conscience.
Wow.
I mean, who would rather see a kid die than get well and get high?
Really?
You know, for asthma, and live 6 to 12 years long. Go home and tell your mama that you want to die 6 to 12 years sooner so you can be a good government person for Bush and Bill Bennett.
Dan
Quayle would probably snort your stuff. In fact, I'd like to see him on a lie detector test.
Okay, now how many signatures do you need for the hemp initiative and for the jury rights initiative?
385,000 valid voter signatures in California for the hemp initiative and 595,000 for the jury rights initiative, which is a constitutional amendment and requires more signatures.
Okay.
We have hundreds of people out now petitioning. We're training them to get good signatures in the first 10 days now But the initiative goes on to early July. We have the time to collect good signatures and teach petitioners. And when we're done, Captain Ed and I have always hoped to have an army of petitioners of 1,000 or 1,500 people that one day are trained from day
freedom
one.
Freedom fighters.
Freedom fighters, yeah. And reefer raiders, maybe. Ronald Reagan said reefer people can never make the ballot, that our minds are too slow. Well, Ronnie, my mind's not too slow, and I don't have to read my lines.
That's right.
Now, do you think you're going to succeed?
Nobody can beat the truth. Can anybody beat the truth?
Absolutely not.
No
way, man.
This man and I have been out there telling the truth, and nobody's ever said we're wrong. They keep arresting us 33 times. They have beaten us in jails. They have done physical things to me I'm not going to describe on this air, but there's nothing that can beat a fact, and there's no, and I don't care how popular a president thinks he is, when people realize that he's killed off a planet and he's killed off the knowledge of a planet, and he's allowed millions of people to die prematurely and in pain and in misery, and has ruined the quality of life that could be gotten with a good, simple medicine that never killed anybody, except at the hands of bad public policy and police carrying out bad public policy with a vengeance.
Get down, dude. Say it like it is. Yeah. Now, if someone wants to say, I want a petition, right?
Yeah.
They want to get involved with this. How do they do it? Who do they contact?
They go
what
to 6702 Van Nuys Boulevard, 6702 Van Nuys Boulevard in Van Nuys, California.
Okay.
And they go to H&H, or they come to 39 Park Avenue in Venice.
All right.
Or call 213-392-1806. 213-392-1806.
All right.
And then you can petition for us. We'll teach you how to petition. We'll put you out in the field. We'll train you. We'll stay out there. We'll keep you all night at the 7-Elevens and the Ralphs getting signatures. and you'll get the munchies legally.
All right. Okay. Now, what are you going to do after you get all the signatures collected? What do you do with them? And then what's the process?
Well, we make sure that all the bad signatures are weeded out. And they're not necessarily bad, but if the petitioner doesn't know the rule, for instance, if somebody signs a petition, Ben Franklin, we have to find out how he spells Franklin with a Y or an I.
Okay.
And then we say, did you have a middle initial? He says, oh yeah, I had an M. And is your name Benjamin or Benji, or was it really Ben or Benet? Oh no, it's Bennett. So we have to find out that information. We have to elicit that. So we get on the petition, on the printed part, Bennett M. Franklin.
Okay.
So they can look up the scribble. They can't even read the scribble of the signature, but they have to have the printed material right. They have to have the address right.
All right.
And that's what we teach. And that's what we do. We look for petitions that are really good and clean, and the ones that are totally unreadable,
we get rid of.
And
they have to be registered voters.
They have to be registered voters and sign it on their own county sheet.
All right. Gentlemen, I have really learned a lot and had a lot of fun having you both on the show.
All right.
It has been exciting and interesting. I hope that this initiative just skyrockets. I understand it's a blueprint for the nation, right?
Yes. Have you seen the back of our shirts?
Nah. Check it out. Paper, fiber, fuel, all the things that you can do with it, right?
Uh-huh.
It's a teaching T-shirt.
Uh-huh.
And it pretty much says it all.
Yeah. And here are the health statistics. You live longer if you smoke pot than if you do no drugs. Uh-huh. And 8 to 24 years longer than people that use alcohol and tobacco.
All right. Well, again, remember the next time that you see me coming across your television screens, you'll know that it's time for hemp. Thank you for tuning in. And remember, only you and I and our brothers and sisters together can make this wonderful plant legal.
Re-legal.
Re-legal again.
Re-legal.
Give you all the lowdown. It's a mess too. Tables were filled with gaudy frails chewing on their fingernails. They were waiting for the man from Harlem. Ah! Oh, there! Oh, drinks were served, 6 bits a throw. Things were moving kind of slow.